Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Paul McLennan on Housing Scotland Bill. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Paul McLennan for around 10 minutes, Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am pleased to make a statement to Parliament on the rent control measures in the Housing Scotland Bill this afternoon. In March this year, the bill was introduced to Parliament, bringing forward a package of reforms which help ensure people have a safe, secure and affordable place to live. The statement today is to provide an update to Parliament on this Government's intentions to bring forward an amendment to the rent control measures as currently set out in the bill at Stage 2. This amendment will deliver on the commitment to provide further certainty in how rent control will be implemented that was set out in the programme for Government published in September. The proposal that I will set out offers clarity on how rents will be capped in areas where rent control is applied. This Government remains committed to delivering long-term rent control, to stabilise rents where this is needed to protect the social and economic interests of tenants who rely on the private rented sector for a home. And of course, eradicating child poverty remains this Government's priority, and I'm sure that we can all agree that having a home can make a direct contribution to achieving this. This is why we're ensuring families can have secure and affordable homes that meet their needs as part of our approach to tackling the housing emergency. This Government has a strong record of acting to protect tenants, recognising that households in rented sectors are more likely to be in relative poverty and to be financially vulnerable. Scotland has the strongest tenants' rights in the world, and this Government acted to mitigate this impact of cost of living crisis for tenants in 2022 through our Emergency Cost of Living Tenant Protection Act, protecting tenants by stabilising their housing costs and preventing most evictions. Scottish tenants alone in the UK had that protection. The introduction of a long-term system of rent control for Scotland builds on this record, working towards a fair and well-regulated private rented sector that delivers for tenants and responsible landlords. It's another step in ensuring that we make further progress towards Scottish tenants being able to access a secure, affordable rented home. However, it's clear that this must be done in a balanced way that provides appropriate protection for the property rights of landlords and in a way that continues to support investment into private rented housing. This will make sure the system of rent control introduced continues to support the supply of rented housing, recognising that the rented sector is a critical part of Scotland's overall housing system. The amendment that will be brought forward by this Government at Stage 2 has been developed in a way that recognises the need to strike the balance as a key driver in the approach to its implementation. I have been grateful for the opportunity to give evidence to both the Local Government and Housing and the Social Security and Social Justice Committees as part of that process over the last few months, and to see and hear the evidence that has come forward as part of their considerations. I have also continued to engage widely with stakeholders and have had the opportunity to hear details from tenants, from landlords, from investors and from developers on the rent control measures in the bill. Through the work of the Housing Investment Task Force, there has been an opportunity to work directly with investors and developers to understand how we can bring forward a system of rent control that both works for tenants and supports continued investment in private rented housing. And recognising the role of social landlords play through offering properties at mid-market rent levels to support those in lower incomes, it has also been helpful to hear from the Scottish Federation of Housing Association members on how rent controls will affect these registered social landlords who offer mid-market provision. It has been positive to see across all stakeholders as a consistent view that Scotland needs a thriving private rented sector, one that offers good quality, affordable housing options and values the benefit that investment in rented property delivers. It is also clear that all those involved in the rented sector recognise the contribution that a good quality, affordable and well-regulated housing system makes in tackling poverty. In these discussions, there have been ongoing calls for further certainty in how rent control will be implemented and how rents will be capped in areas where rent control applies. To respond to this, the Programme for Government made a commitment to bring forward amendment to the bill to clearly set out how rent increases will be capped in areas where rent controls apply. Now, having considered how to best formulate the cap, the Government will bring forward amendment at Stage 2 that will explicitly set out where a rent control area is designated. The cap that will apply to rent increases while rent control is in force would be set at a level of CPI plus 1% up to a maximum increase of 6%. This would mean that where a rent control area is in place, in most cases rents would be able to increase by CPI plus 1% of the existing rent. Where the relevant CPI figure exceeds 5%, then an increase permitted would be capped at 6% of the existing rent. The rent cap will apply to rent increases both during the term of tenancy and in between tenancies, in the period where an area is designated for rent control. Bringing forward this amendment responds directly to calls for greater certainty and will offer more clarity to tenants, landlords and those who invest in and develop rented homes. And setting out the form of this cap in this way, with CPI as the basis, allows for a reflection of the costs of landlords to offering a property for rent whilst providing protection for tenants in terms of limiting more significant rent increases. This approach has been shaped by input from stakeholders on how to develop an approach to rent control that provides protection for tenants whilst continuing to support investment in new and improved private housing. Now, turning to other measures in the bill where further detail on how rent control will be implemented would be welcomed by stakeholders. The bill contains powers for Scottish ministers to make regulations that will allow for certain types of property to be exempted from rent control and for rents to be increased above the level of the rent cap in some circumstances. The bill currently sets out any such exemptions or modifications and how the cap will apply shall be supported by consultation with tenants, landlords and others who may have an interest. It is essential that the circumstances where such exemptions or modifications to the cap is applied are subject to full and open consultation, allowing all of those affected to have their views considered. This will make sure that the impacts of any decisions on how these powers are used can be fully understood and the measures are developed in a way that is fair, robust against challenge and can clearly be set out in legislation. In order to respond to the calls for further clarity in respect of these aspects of the rent control system at the earliest opportunity, the consultation will support decisions on how these powers may well be used will be brought forward in early spring 2025. The consultation will build on the work already carried out to support the development of the rent control measures in the bill, in particular the landlord and tenant questionnaire that was issued in October 2023. That questionnaire sought views on allowing increases above the rent cap, whether there had been improvements to the quality of fixtures and fittings, or the energy efficiency of the rented property, or where the landlord's costs incurred in letting the property have increased. And reflecting on an important part that investment plays in growing the supply of housing, including in the private rented sector, the questionnaire sought views on circumstances where exempting certain types of property from rent control could be considered. Specifically, it highlighted rented property offered for social good, with rents controlled below market level, and purpose-built accommodation for rent at scale. The feedback from the questionnaire will feed into the development of the consultation, and there will be continued engagement with stakeholders on the circumstances where it may be appropriate to exempt certain types of property to either apply a modified rent cap over the next few months. This engagement will inform what is brought forward in the consultation in early spring 2025. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, this Government remains committed to bring forward a system of rent control that works for Scotland, a system that supports stabilisation of rents for tenants, whilst ensuring that it can be a balanced approach that provides appropriate protection for the property rights of landlords and supports investment into the development of rented homes. The amendment that the Government will bring forward at Stage 2 to set out the form of the rent cap will help support the delivery of these aims, and I look forward to continuing to work with Parliament as the Bill continues its progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business. And I'd invite members wishing to ask a question who haven't already done so to press the request to speak buttons. Call first Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can also thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. The Housing Bill was the opportunity for this SNP Government to address the housing emergency. Yet this statement does nothing to address the housing shortage or reassure housing developers or landlords that this government understands the issue at hand. The Minister has already taken a sledgehammer to the rental market, and this announcement today will only cause further worry to an already unsteady housing sector. As this government is hell-bent on being anti-house building, developers have axed plans to deliver hundreds of more houses since the introduction of the SNP rent cap legislation. Yep. And because of the SNP, around £3.2 billion worth of built-to-rent developments have stalled. So how on earth will we tackle this housing emergency if this government doesn't understand that we need to build, 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 not cap, cap, cap? So can I ask the Minister, Has this government consulted with build-to-rent developers regarding these proposals? And if he's serious about addressing housing shortages, is he prepared to exempt rent controls for social housing?
Yeah. Minister.
Can I thank the member for her question? A couple of key points before I get on to one of the main points. If we're talking about house building, the biggest impact we've had in house building, obviously, was the capital cut that this government had to suffer from the UK government, that 9% capital cut. In terms of that, another biggest issue in terms of that as well was obviously the impact of local housing allowance, again, through your government. In terms of the point that you raised around about consulting with the sector itself, we set up the Housing Investment Task Force back in April last year, which includes investors themselves, a number of investors, and we've consulted on the proposals with them, and we'll continue to do so as in the consultation that I've set out. What this does is this gives certainty in terms of to investors in that regard. We will continue to go forward in that respect. And through the chair, President Officer, I think that these discussions will continue to involve the investors as we go forward.
Thank you. Mark Griffin.
Thank you, President Officer. After years of talking, the government finally managed to introduce a bill on rent control, but somehow didn't include any actual detail on rent control. Within it, the government have now plugged one gap in a framework bill, but ignored the fact that the dam's collapsing around it and the thousands of people in temporary accommodation right now. More detail on rent control has been demanded, and so is welcome, but this housing bill still builds not a single house and provides no support to local authorities dealing with a housing crisis. Now, given the content of the statement on amendments and regulations, the government also seem to accept that this housing bill is lacking in fundamental detail. So then, Presiding Officer, can I ask the Minister if he agrees that the bill should be fundamentally redrafted, subject to full scrutiny and consultation by this Parliament, to give tenants, landlords, councils and house builders the certainty they need to get on with tackling this housing emergency?
Minister.
Thank you, Member, for his question. A number of points. The Housing Bill, although we're talking about rent controls today, obviously mentions about prevention duties, something that the Member is well aware of, and we're consulting and working very closely with the sector on that particular point. So that's a prevention point of view. I think, as mentioned to Megan Gallagher, one of the key things is around about giving that the certainty. And I think that was something that the sector itself have been saying to us over a number of months. So this is what we're trying to provide today. I also mentioned about the consultation. We've had extensive consultation with them already as we develop the bill, and it still goes in time in terms of the timing with the bill. We'll have extensive consultation, as I've mentioned there before, including local authorities, including investors, including registered social landlords in terms of that. So that consultation has already been extensive and will continue to be so as we go forward in the next number of months.
Emma Ruddock, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware that many people who have spoken out on the need for rent controls have highlighted the imbalance of power that exists in private tenancy agreements, with tenants often afraid to raise issues or escalate unfair actions. How will the rent control proposals ensure that tenants have protection and power, with the onus on landlords to justify rent increases, not the tenant to fight against them?
Minister.
For her question, I know, and she's raised this on a number of occasions, requiring all rent increases to be assessed or approved by an external decision maker would be resource intensive and obviously administratively burdensome for landlords. The Scottish Government considers that the majority of landlords are good landlords who seek to comply with legislation and to provide a good experience for tenants living in their properties. However, in cases where an incorrect rent increase is proposed, either in error or because the landlord chooses to act unlawfully, there are routes of challenge provided in the bill. Before making an application to a rent officer or to the tribunal under these routes, a tenant will be required to make their landlord aware of the issue and give them reasonable time to respond. This will give landlords an opportunity to resolve cases of genuine error.
Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Christine Graham.
President Officer, I have met with many house developers here in Edinburgh and Lothian, and they all tell me that they are going to act plans to deliver hundreds more houses here in this city because of rent controls. Does he accept that in the medium to long term we will see fewer houses built because of this policy? Yes or no?
Minister.
I think one of the key things investors have been saying to myself in terms of that is giving them certainty, and we've certainly given them that today. In terms of moving forward, we talked about the consultation. mentioned around about the Housing Investment Task Force, which again has been discussing this particular issue. There have been discussions with investors on this particular issue around about rent controls themselves, so they've been well involved in that. So the purpose of today is to give that certainty to allow to move forward and a full discussion in the consultation. One of the key things, obviously, about rent controls, which I think is really important to keep in mind in this debate, is how we tackle poverty. There are far too many people in poverty. And just yesterday, Shelter came out and said rocketing private rents is tearing communities apart, pricing families out of their local areas, and pushing, this is a UK figure, over 151,000 children into homelessness. This is about tackling poverty, as well as bringing investment in as well.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. The memorandum to the bill states, quotes, the bill has no significant differential effects upon island and rural communities, close quotes. I represent basically rural communities. In the statement, it says it will say where a rent control is in place and secondly, how rents will be capped. Now, it's a very different problem of rural areas from urban areas. So how will that take account of rurality?
Minister.
Yeah, and I think that's a really important point. I know it was mentioned in committee. Rent control measures are being brought forward to create a nationally consistent approach that's able to take account of local circumstances. We're conscious, obviously, of the concerns raised by rural landlords regarding the operation of rural housing markets in the sector. We'll continue to engage with stakeholders in this sector as we continue to progress towards the consultation in spring 2025.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
Given how important robust data on both rent levels and housing quality are, what steps will the Minister take to ensure that councils have a rigorous, transparent and properly funded process for collecting this data? And where, for example, in the Landlord Register, do the Scottish Government envisage this data being stored?
Minister.
Thank the member for her question. I think one of the key things has been working closely with the local authorities, presiding officers, to understand how they will use these powers. I think in terms of being resourced properly, I think that comes into obviously the financial memorandum around about that, and there are discussions continuing, which will be again brought forward at stage two of the bill on that particular point, and I think that's really important. Now, we are aware of existing data gaps in the private rented sector. So we've brought forward legislation in the bill which will give local authorities the power to collect data directly from landlords, underpinning effective rent control area assessments. Now, this engagement will inform any necessary longer-term data development work, ensuring we are collecting right data in a practical and cost-effective way to support our long-term aspirations.
Eleanor Whittam, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
These amendments help to provide the clarity required to implement a sustainable rent control system for Scotland, balancing vital protections for tenants with the need for investment in our housing supply. We certainly need to build. Can the Minister set out in more detail steps the Government has taken to ensure confidence amongst investors, whilst also crucially protecting tenants by preventing homelessness? And has the Minister given consideration to testing or piloting the new prevention duties ahead of their full rollout to ensure effectiveness?
Minister.
On the prevention duties part, first of all, I think that's an incredibly important part. I know today we're talking about rent controls, but on the prevention duties, we've met a number of stakeholders, and already we were encouraging stakeholders, whether it's the local authorities, whether it's prison service and so on, around about trying to bring some of these prevention duties in just now. It doesn't require legislation for us to do so. On the investment point that she mentions, we'll continue to work with stakeholders across tenants, landlords and investors as we develop a system of rent control that works for Scotland, that brings in investment but also tackles poverty. This legislation needs to be robust and it needs to be fit for purpose. And the issues stakeholders are raising about rent control investment will be an important consideration in the implementation of rent control. I previously mentioned around about the work of the Housing Investment Task Force. This was set up in March 2024 and will continue to identify actions that will unlock both existing and new commitments to investing in housing by bringing together key interests of investors and investees.
Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Greens do not believe that this formulation will actually tackle the significant unaffordability of rents in many areas across the country. It does not give tenants in the private rented sector the security or stability they've been promised. Can the Minister explain just how legislation requiring that rents always increase above the level of inflation, even in rent control areas, makes housing costs more affordable for tenants over time or helps to tackle child poverty?
Minister.
Thank the member for her question. It's important that any design of rent controls considers a longer-term picture, since rental growth can be below as well as above inflation. We consider that allowing some margin over inflation, such as 1% that's been mentioned today, would give investors some assurance that over the long run, any periods when growth is below inflation may be balanced out with periods where rents may grow a little above inflation. In terms of the affordability point that she mentioned, a good quality, affordable and well-regulated housing system generates benefits that can tackle poverty, as she's mentioned, including for families with children, promote equality and support well-being. Now, rent control is designed to help stabilise rents where market rents have been increasing particularly steeply, but we need to make sure that we're bringing investment into the sector as well. And I suppose just on affordability, affordability itself is probably much broader than just in what we're talking about here. And yesterday afternoon, I was disappointed that the Labour government and its budget abandoned, I suppose, tenants in that regard when it failed to uplift the LHA in the budget. And I think that's one of the key things as part of the discussions we'll continue to push the Labour government on. Affordability is much broader than the points that Maggie Chapman makes.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Ben McPherson.
It's not especially clear, but it looks like the government's moving to exclude mid-market rents from the rent controls, and the minister's nodding that that is what the intention is. And I think that would make sense because it would secure extra investment into the sector, whilst also treating mid-market rents as the same basis as social housing. So for clarity, is that what the minister's planning? But secondly, when will this be done by?
Minister.
I think there's a number of things that Mr Rennie, and I appreciate that he's mentioned this on a number of occasions, and I talked to him about the consultation. One of the key things, I think, for me when we were preparing this bill, one was obviously the point around about how do we tackle poverty, and I think that's incredibly important, and we can't forget that. But we need to make sure that we get investment into the sector as well. So we recognise the important part that investment plays in that. Now, I think as part of our work, and to seek views, I mentioned previously about the landlord and tenant consultation questionnaire in October 2023. So that will be going out and speaking on a number of issues and that particular point. I think we mentioned about the consultation coming forward in spring 2025, Mr Rennie. And again, obviously, that I think it's within the proposed timeline for the bill, that will still not delay the bill in coming forward in that particular point. But again, looking forward to discussing this with Mr Rennie going forward.
Ben McPherson to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
According to the Office of National Statistics, for my constituents, on average, rents have increased by around 14% in the last year compared with 7% across Scotland. That's why, particularly among young people renting to look for their own home, there is noticeable support for effective rent controls in the capital city. However, I also appreciate there is a need to increase supply and attract investment within a UK finance market. Therefore, how will today's update help to achieve the balance to meet both of these important aims, especially to help tackle Edinburgh's housing emergency?
Minister.
Thank the member for that question. And on a few points during this discussion, I mentioned around about the balance. And the balance, obviously, is mentioned around about how we tackle the poverty element of that. And I think that's one of the most important things. But one of the issues around about affordability as well is also around about supply and demand. So how do we increase that supply in Edinburgh? Now, I know Edinburgh Council recently just passed a motion in supporting rent controls in principle. But one of the key things they've been saying to me as well is that we need to get investment into the city as well. So I think what we're trying to do through the discussions we've been having with Edinburgh and also through the bill and obviously through the consultation is making sure we get that investment as well that tackles the supply issue that we're dealing with, but also allows us, through the rent controls, to tackle the poverty issue.
Graeme Simpson to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you. I'm going to press the Minister for the third time on what he thinks about mid-market rent properties. Does he think that they should be exempt from rent controls or not? And if he does think they should be exempt, why can't we do this at stage two?
Minister.
Yeah, I think one of the key things all the way through this process is that we're making sure we're taking responsibilities and reviews and views of people in the sector. So we'll be consulting the consultation that I mentioned at that particular time. We'll be consulting on exemptions. It's important it's not just where we're speaking today, Mr Simpson's around about. It would be important that we speak to as many stakeholders as possible, where there are different interests in terms of that. The reason that we're bringing out that consultation is to talk around about exemptions.
Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Many of my constituents would have found yesterday's UK government budget disappointing due to a lack of action to correct insufficient local housing allowance rates, with one-bedroom flats in Edinburgh renting for over £1,000 a month, Could the Minister set out why rent controls are so key to stabilising rent and protecting tenants' bills in Scotland?
Minister.
The member for his question. Families who rely on housing benefits to cover the rent need certainty to be able to plan for the future and put down roots. I mentioned before in the answer to Mr Griffin, I think the UK government's decision to maintain the freeze in electricity rates leaves families in an uncertain position, and I regret that they didn't make that change. So looking at rent controls obviously gives some certainty around about that. The Scottish Government have repeatedly called, from the previous Tory government to the now Labour government, to call for electricity rates to be linked to real-world rents. And it's really disappointing that the Labour Party have not done that, and I would hope Mark Griffin can continue to push his UK colleagues on that. If families can't rely on UK government assistance with their housing costs, then rent controls become even more necessary to help families know if they'll be able to turn the heating on or feed their children.
And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister will know that effective rent controls require really detailed and comprehensive supporting measures. For example, in Glasgow, when rent controls were introduced over a century ago, it led to a collapse in factoring of tenement stock in the city. So will the Minister ensure that in introducing rent controls, he will also expedite measures such as mandatory owners associations, five-yearly tenement building inspections and compulsory building reserve funds to ensure that we don't see a decline in the quality of our housing stock?
Minister.
Member for his question, and one of the main reasons, Presiding Officer, that we are consulting is for that very reason, to make sure there are no unintended consequences of the legislation that we bring forward. So the reason we're going out and doing that is to raise the points and speak to the points that Mr Sweeney has raised at that particular point, and looking forward to discuss that if he wishes to do so in the future going ahead.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the ministerial statement. There'll be a brief pause to allow front benches to change before we move on to the next item of business.